Continuing more or less on the same theme, but I think we are going to have a somewhat more focused discussion this morning. We are going to be looking at the role of private industry in the defense sector. We had titled as UK experience and the Indian requirement, but I think the defense secretary made a very fitting twist to the whole panel theme. I think we are going to be looking at the Indian requirement and what is that UK can do, what's the UK requirement, and how can we work together in this regard. It's an important subject, and I think particularly when you look at India has been making some changes. India is moving away from a purely state-owned defense enterprise to one that would see a large private sector participation in a sense. And I think the current government has made a few, taken a few initiatives, Make in India, and itself, that itself has undergone some changes, Make in India, Make and Buy in India, and so on and so forth. But I think there is a larger set of issues that we have to deal with. Having started this process a couple of years ago, it's not been entirely smooth. It's not been entirely, we haven't gone very far with it. So it'll be actually pretty interesting and useful to see how the other countries, have successfully managed this transition to a larger private sector participation in their own sector, in their own, within their own countries, or countries that have actually had a large private sector industry participation right from the beginning. So I think it's a fitting time to take a look at some of these countries, some of the other countries, learn there from their experiences, some of the pitfalls to avoid, as well as the successful models that we can emulate within India in a sense. I'm not a particularly big expert on the subject, so I think I'm going to get our experts to speak to us, and then open up for Q&A. We have an excellent panel this morning to deliberate on this panel discussion. So we have Stephen Phipson, who is the head of the Defence and Security Organisation within the UK Trade and Industry Body. We have Lieutenant General Mark Poffley, who will be joining us a little later. We have Lieutenant General S. Narasimhan, who is the member of the National Security Advisory Board, India. And last but not the least, we have Vishal Nigam, who is Vice President of Bharat Forge. We are doing sufficiently well on time, but I think we can start with maybe 10 to 12 minutes per speaker so that we have adequate time for Q&A and discussion. May I now call upon Mr. Priyam Phipson to make his presentation? Thank you.
Thank you very much, and good morning still to everyone here. So just to be clear, Stephen Phipson, I run the government agency in the UK government that supports both the defence and the security sectors in terms of developing their business overseas. It's a function that we've had for a long time, and I think following on from our comments of our Secretary of State, I wanted to try and give you an idea as to why we have an agency like this, what the work of the agency does, how that reflects with our defence industry, and how that interaction actually works. Secretary of State talks about the transition over the last 7 years, but of course we've also been going through a transition from public to private ownership of the UK defence industry for many decades. That process is a very long-term process. And in doing that, the government recognised early on that you have to set the right conditions for private ownership of defence assets and defence companies in the country. Some of those conditions were around the procurement reforms that recently have been implemented even more stringently than they were before, that the Defence Secretary spoke about. Some of them had been around the rules around sharing intellectual property, and one of the deals was also around the export market and how governments would support companies to promote their products overseas. If you think about the UK, why is this important to us in government? Our defence industry is around about £24 billion a year in sales, to give you an idea of it. It consists of around about 12,000 companies, of which 20 of them are what we call prime contractors, the people that take the platform contracts from the MOD and then the SME community and the supply chain community that supports them. £24 billion a year of sales. The MOD buys from the UK industry about £16 billion a year. £20 billion, which was the point that the Defence Secretary made, includes what we place to overseas companies as well. And if you look at the UK part of that, it's about £16 billion a year. So that means there's £8 billion a year which are exported. And it's important that government supports that £8 billion a year of activity. It does two things for us. It increases our economies of scale in the UK so that the companies are more efficient. And bearing in mind that through the more competitive process of our procurement, they've already become quite efficient. So this adds to the economies of scale that we've got, which benefits of us back in the government in terms of costs of equipment and processes that we actually purchase. So it certainly does that. It also increases the proposition of those companies to be able to invest in the UK in innovation. So the higher their volume, the more business that they're able to win, the more we encourage them to invest in R&D and indeed co-invest with the Ministry of Defence and our other ministries in terms of developing the capability for our own armed forces. And we do that very much as a partnership together. We work very closely together to enable that virtuous cycle of supporting business to grow, reinvestment from the private sector, developing our future military capability is the way that we operate our defence sector in the UK and have done for some time. To give you an idea of the maturity of that process, the DSO operation was started in 1966. So in fact, it's just over 50 years old. So in terms of what I do, I'm one of a number of series now. I've not been in the job 50 years, but certainly we've had a number of heads of DSO, mostly from industry, coming into government to run the agency to support how the government and industry works together on those export activities. So I think that's a really interesting learning piece about the way we've had industry and government collaborating together for the longer term good. That's very important, alongside creating those conditions to make it possible to have a thriving private defence sector. That's critical. In terms of the way that we do that, in terms of the way that the Defence and Security Organisation works within government, it's quite interesting. We have a prioritisation process. So we work on around 35 countries around the world. India is one of the priorities. So these are our closest allies, the people that we want to be able to share our military experience with and our military capability with. So we've gone through quite a rigorous process to select those initial priority countries. In each of those countries, I then have someone sitting, a first secretary sitting in the embassy of that country, who is charged with developing the relationship with the defence authorities in that country on behalf of industry and on behalf of government. It's a dual relationship push that happens there to make these contracts happen. And then we have a team back in the UK, and half of my team are serving military and security officers from other government departments that are the experts in their particular discipline. So I have on my team submarine captains, fast jet pilots, you name it. Every single discipline I need to be able to talk to overseas governments about their requirements with a professional outlook. And that's the support then that the UK industry gets in terms of promoting those products overseas. So what we do is we identify 5 years going forward in each of those countries, what their programs are. Then we form teams, which we call integrated campaign teams, which incorporates our military and our commercial expertise, putting them all together into a campaign team. And then we work together to deliver that capability overseas, whether it's a fast jet program, a helicopter, a weapon system, or whatever else. And that process, that rigorous process of identification, follow-up, relationship building, working closely with industry, makes the UK the second largest on average defence exporter in the world. And we're very proud to be in that position. The point I would like to make, I think, which is important, again, for learning for India, is that the world is changing. For most of its 50 years of history, in terms of us doing this in government, it's been about exporting equipment. It's becoming less and less about exporting equipment. It's becoming more and more about exporting technology and expertise. Also, you'd have heard our Secretary of State talking about the fact that we went through a review to determine what government should do and what government should outsource to the private sector. And so increasingly, a large part of our exports is around the services sector, the services that have been employed in delivering our defence capability, how to run bases, how to do training, how to do a whole range of other things other than just be able to export the hardware that's associated with the military capability. So a lot of this is around how we move technology from the UK in a controlled environment to our partners, how we then benefit in terms of people building their own indigenous requirements, how we benefit that process, how we deliver to that country expertise that we've been able to develop. And then importantly for us, not only do we export that expertise, that intellectual property, but then working on co-development programs with that country to be able to develop new capability. And that's the objective we want to get to next in terms of the longer term of working with countries that want to develop their own indigenous capability. India is in exactly that space. So in terms of maintaining our position as a leading exporter of defense equipment and services, we see that as a process by which we can do that. And we also see that as a process by which countries like India can get much more self-sufficient with a privatized industrial sector that's able to export professionally to third parties overseas. So I think I'll pause there, Madam Chairman, and we can take the next speaker, I think. Yeah?
Thank you very much, Mr. Professor. I think we had some really a lot of interesting things that you talked about, and I think the most pertinent point that you raised about is not exporting any more hardware and the technology and the exporting equipments per se, but exporting of the technologies and the talent. And I think that's something that the Indian sector, defense sector, is particularly looking at coming out with the Make in India initiatives and the other associated programs. So I think there will be a lot of Q&A once we open up. But now let me invite the second panelist, General Narasimhan. You can use the platform there. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a privilege to share a few thoughts on the most important subject that has been actually going on in the minds of the Indians, the Indian defense industry alike, for the last couple of years. Firstly, we all know, prior to 2001, mainly the defense public sector undertakings were the ones which are catering for the requirement of the armed forces. The private sector was not actually open to this particular subject. It helped in creating an industrial base of 39 ordnance factories, 8 DPSUs, and approximately 50 R&D labs. The aim was to create a 70% indigenization process and 30% for imports. But somehow or the other, the process was reversed actually. We achieved approximately about 30% of the indigenization and 70% was still being imported. The effect of imports actually was telling on us. Heavy outflow of foreign exchange reserves, technological levels not improved, critical components were vulnerable when it was required, lack of innovation and upgradation, poor quality control, export promotion, poor finance and HR management, all those things came up because of the monopoly that the defense public sector undertakings had. Something wrong with this. Yeah. In 2001, the defense sector, defense industry, was open to the private sector. And before that, they only supplied the raw material, components, some spares, and semi-finished products to the defense industry. At that time, 26% of the FDI was permitted. And 100% private sector participation with industrial licensing was brought in. Joint ventures with Australia, Singapore, Israel, and Russia started at that time. And there was a policy called Raksha Udyog Ratna policy, in which approximately 12 companies were included. And later on, of course, it was done away with. And state support to defense public sector undertakings continued. Offset policy was brought in. 30% direct offsets for contracts over 3,000 million rupees was brought in. Enhancing of the technological capability was brought in. Transfer of technology, R&D, license production, all those things can be done with this offset at that point in time. Then from 2005 onwards, a new defense procurement policy was brought in. It went through various iterations, and the latest one which came up was Defense Procurement Policy 2016, which with less the chapter on partnership, annexures, appendices, schedules came up. The rest of the things have already come out. The strategic partnership chapter is yet to come out. there are some indication that it might come out reasonably soon. The type of procurements were classified into five categories in this defense procurement policy. Why I'm highlighting this is basically we need to understand what kind of procurement processes we are looking at. And the issues those are listed there, the issues that are related to that, basically the proof of the indigenous design. The first one, the by Indian, IDDM means indigenously designed, developed, and manufactured, should have a 40% indigenous content in design. If it is done in collaboration with foreign companies, it should have 60% indigenous content in design. So what invariably happened was that the proof of indigenous design lay with the industry. A committee system was formed wherein the DRDO and the service headquarters were supposed to check on this, and they actually at the moment need more expertise to deal with this. The authorities can lay down higher percentage of indigenization when they go for the requirement, and it was difficult for the aircraft industry basically because the indigenization process was only 20%. Majority of the components were getting imported. Some of the successful projects that the private industry took over are the high mobility vehicles, modernization of airfield infrastructure, which is called MAFI. About 30 airfields were involved in this. Self-propelled howitzers, integrated electronic warfare in mountains. And the key private players were Bharat Forge, the representative is sitting here with us, Tata, Larsen & Toubro, Mahindra and Reliance. 31 out of the 34 joint ventures that were formed by the private industry. And 60% of the defense exports are being done by the private industry today. That is the stage we have come to from where we were in 2001. The challenges that the private industry faces today, one of the industrial licenses and the process along with it, that go with it, the payment terms that the private industry faces when compared to the foreign companies which can obtain the payments on a letter of credit, the tax and duty structure, the foreign exchange rate variation which is compensated for the foreign companies, which is not for the Indian companies, the financial and fiscal incentives which are not actually come into being. Basically, a couple of examples can be looked into. The Republic of Korea has got a self-defense tax which ran for about 10 years. Israel actually gives 10-15% less price for the local enterprises. And the surety of orders is actually what the private industry is looking at, which they are at the moment not getting. They're also looking at a level playing field. The time taken for the awarding of the contract, which they feel is very long. The delay in payments after the contracts have been achieved, the R&D, which is actually still lacking in India today because the expenditure on the R&D is abysmal at this moment, the skill development for which they need to work on, and the lack of representation in the Defence Ministry, which actually contributes to the lack of level playing field. These are the challenges that they generally feel that they have. And the initiatives which the government has taken now recently, industrial licensing, most of the components have been removed from the list to reduce the entry barriers. The exports list has been made public. The end user certificates have been rationalized. The defense public sector undertakings and private sector on par for exchange rate variation at this point. And the customs and excise duty regimes are being looked into. The customs duty exemption that was given to the defense ministry has been done away with to give a level playing field and to also to encourage Make in India. Enhanced government funding and reservation for certain projects for micro, small, medium enterprises. And the IDDM has been the preferred category, likely to bring in more R&D into India. The FDI has been increased to 49%, and in some cases, on a case-by-case basis, on the government route to 100%. Guidelines for DPSUs and the Ordnance Factory Board for outsourcing and vendor development has been issued. Offset partners can be prescribed later also. Initially, when you enter into a contract, at the initial stage of the contract itself, you're supposed to identify your offset partner. That has been now done away with. The no objection certificates now are available online for exports and other things. Make in India portal has been established. And the renewal of the registration of the companies can be now done on the self-certification basis. So basically, what has happened is the industry's problem that they were facing are actually being now looked at certain initiatives. They are yet to take a good shape on ground, but they are in the process. I'll finish here. Rest of the things we'll take it on the on the question and answer session. Thank you.
Thank you, General. I think that was a fairly comprehensive overview of where India started and how India is transitioning to bring in the large private sector, private industry participation, and some of the challenges, hurdles as we move ahead in a sense. Now, let me welcome the third speaker, Vishal Nigam, to address us on the subject. Thank you.
Thanks, Raji. Sorry for the delay. There was an issue in terms of the presentation. You know, before I start, let me just tell you where I come from. I work for Bharat Forge Limited, which is the flagship company of the Kalyani Group. We largely operate in under six verticals, manufacturing wide range of high performance critical and safety equipment. Over the years, we are transforming from being competent suppliers to becoming development partners, and we've done that through focus on process, innovation, technology, and value add. Where do we intend to go? We intend to, you know, make substantive progress in the future in terms of adapting to technology, looking at new technology in the field of 3D, that is additive manufacturing, electron beam welding, whether it's laser welding, MIM, or for that matter, nano. By the way, we also participate in India's defense economy. And today's topic is not about Bharat Forge, so I'm going to focus on the defense economy, but my mandate here is not to tell identify areas where we could partner with the UK. I leave that to the policymakers. What I'm going to do is identify some pain points that we have as an industry and learn from the UK experience. As the secretary mentioned, they have 50 years of experience. We are still very early in that stage, and that is where my discussion is going to be focused on. So, you know, why focus on defense economy, or why focus on indigenizing India's defense economy? We're doing pretty well as far as growth of the Indian economy is concerned. We're growing at 7%. We are pretty much an attractive economy. We have services, sectors like services, IT, whether it is pharmaceuticals or even gems and jewelry, contributing substantively to India's growth story. So why focus on the defense economy? And the reason for that is very, very simple. We are an aspirational society. Our aspirations are to elevate the status of our country to that of a great power. And surely we can't do that on the back of services, IT, pharmaceuticals, or for that matter, gems and jewelry. And hence, we have to grow, if we have to, on the back of manufacturing, where manufacturing is not supported by an imported value chain, but by an indigenous value chain. And hence, we need to build our own capability. You know, keeping that in mind, I believe that the government a few years ago identified defense as the core sector, not only in the manufacturing sector, but out of the 25 key sectors. And the reason it did that was to drive and unleash innovation in the country, manufacturing, and elevate India's status to that of a preferred manufacturing destination. Well, do we have that capability? I will discuss that in due course of my presentation. But where are we right now in this historic curve of power? Quite clearly, we are rising. Are we there to take the responsibility of becoming a great power? Obviously, we are not. We are putting in place the sinews of power. We're gradually accumulating. And in that context, we are looking to revolutionize our defense economy. But how do we do that? Very clearly, government has acknowledged that there's a need to reduce state control. You require greater accountability, greater efficiency, need a more collaborative approach with the private sector industries, which apparently is happening. We need to outsource and subcontract production and R&D to private sector. There are a large number of medium and small scale enterprises in this country who are extremely innovative. And they have great potential to contribute to the growth of India's defense economy. We have to do that, we have to reduce the protracted timelines. And that, in a way, would also reduce the cost and, in turn, upgrade and indigenize capabilities in the country. Where are we right now on the growth part of developed defense industries? UK spent about 50 years. We spent just a few years, to be precise, 15 odd years in this aspiration of ours. So we clearly, in the early stages, and probably between the early and the growth stage. So we still have a few steps to climb before we elevate our status. And to do that, we need to see if there are opportunities. And when you look at that across the services, you have tremendous opportunities, primarily because we are in the process of replacing our inventory, also upgrading some of them, buying new inventory, and hence there is huge opportunity in the defense sector. Now, will participation in the defense economy really, you know, add to India's growth engine? I'm not sure. And that is really not the focus of why we want to participate in the defense economy. There was a slide which many of us sitting in the audience would have seen it many a times. And there was this report which came out 10 to 15 years ago stating that if we participate and we reduce the self-reliance index by X percentage, you'd have more jobs. But that is not the point of concern. What's going to happen when you participate in the defense economy is that it is going to add value to India's innovative index, and that is important. Let's do a reality check as to where we are. We have the framework in place, we have everything going, we know the direction, we see the opportunity, but there's a real problem there. The vehicle is just not moving, and we need to sort out that problem, and that's where we can take the help of our partners from UK and help us solve the problem. To do that, we need to see where we were in the past and where are we today. General Narasimhan did mention all the issues that were challenges in the past, and many of them have been addressed. One of the greatest challenges probably at the beginning of this decade was we always spoke about the lack of vision. We also spoke about extremely slow decision making. There were occasional outbursts in terms of indigenization, talking about the skewed self-reliance index that persists in this country. Few practical measures were taken, though. And at times what happened was, in the eagerness to change, we made a number of iterations as far as the policy was concerned. We changed the DPP a number of times. We brought in a number of revisions, and it's all okay because the process itself is evolutionary. We need to find the right process according to our characteristics and not according to what exists elsewhere. So that is absolutely fine. Also, in terms of the process was always charged that it favored foreign equipment. And you know, the reason that the DPSUs or the services used to head was because of the extremely skewed or inverted duty structure. And this was again a slide which was flashed many a time by some the participants sitting here as well, that when you look at the duty structure which was prevalent, it was cheaper to buy equipments from abroad. And if one carried out value addition in India, it was about 16 to 25% more expensive. There was also issues regarding the exchange rate variation, which apparently been sorted out. Also about the LC payments, which General Narasimhan alluded to. So a lot's been done. There has been a great deal of traction, at least at the policy level, when you look at the defense economy. Policy, by and large, is set. Obviously, we need more changes to happen. They will happen. But there's a perceptible shift towards Indian industry. That's good news. There's a new categorization which favors Make in India, which General Narasimhan also alluded to. I'm not going to talk about that. The FDI now has been enhanced to 49%, and if required, 100%. But is foreign direct investment the panacea for all our problems? Obviously, it's not. There were issues regarding control and ownerships which existed have been solved. Institutional investors were not permitted earlier to participate in the sense that if an Indian industry had institutional investors, it could not participate. That issue has been sorted out. There are many large programs which are now gravitating towards the Indian private sector. the number of press notes which were released in 2015 and 16, at times it was difficult to even track them, and that was all a result of the policy changes. The government was ready to listen to you. The government was ready to make changes, but there is a difference between changes in the policy and implementation. When you look at licensing, the number of licenses have been reduced. There was a clause in terms of licensing where the validity of license was 3 to 5 years. Now, the process itself at many a times took more than 5 years, and every time it went at the end of 5 years, the private sector company had to go back to the government to extend the validity of the license, and logically it should have been extended, but it was extended in 2015, where they extended the validity to 15 years, extendable to 18. So that was just to make it easier to do business, and India is surely becoming an easier place to do business, not the easiest, but we are moving forward. So what needs to be done next? I think the problem is about access to the market. And how do we access the market? We can only access the market if you have the orders coming up. So what the government can do is probably identify a dozen. I would want a few dozen programs to be identified, but at the moment there are just about two MAKE programs which are running. So we need to have many dozen MAKE programs run driven by timelines, where you have them being driven by an integrated program management team, not for a few years, but for the entire duration of the lifetime of the program. We need some industries which can take the responsibility of delivering these programs to the government. We'll have to have those development agencies participate outside the GFRs. What India needs to do is India has to become a competitive manufacturing destination. You have to unleash manufacturing in a big way, which includes additive, which includes forging and machining, which includes the sunrise sector, and all of this is definitely going to be composites, which would result in value addition and sourcing from India. It's cliche to talk about space and missile, but let me just do that. Like it was done in space and missile, we probably can do that in A&D. A&D has to become a strategic industry where the government will have to hold hands at least for some time in terms of providing infrastructure, SOPs, whether it's R&D, and then you'd probably see this industry blossoming. Now, to understand all this, we always talk about technology. Where are we really in the technology segment? Are we is technology the real issue? I think we are almost there in the adequate, have the capability to move from the adequate to the competent. So in my view, technology is really not the issue. And I can say that in the middle of this decade, in the 21st century, I couldn't have said that probably in the 1980s and 90s. The reason I say that is today many of the private sector industries are global companies. They have experienced success overseas, and they are ready to come and plow back in this country. They are capable of embracing, engaging with niche technologies. Indian industry has delivered state-of-art technology in the past. We can do it in the future. There are some great programs running in this country. When you look at it recently, you have the ATAGS, you have the LCA, which is coming of age. You have almost 50 ships being constructed in this country. So if technology is not the issue, then what is it? What is it that is stopping this vehicle to be moving? And when you look at investments, there are some data which says that there is investment happening in this country. But is investment the real issue? When you look at the FDI market database in global defense, in the last 15 odd years, there are about 250 odd programs with capital investment of about $4.5 billion. In India, you've had almost 400 million foreign capex for 17 projects which have come up. This figure is surely in variance with what is there in DIPP, but the point is not about that. The point is investment the issue, or there is some other problem that is holding this economy to be moving ahead? Infrastructure is there. We need to really reorganize that. policy traction, there's been a great deal of traction in the last at least two and a half years that's taken place at the policy level. But process is something that is really holding us back. And until and unless you don't address the processes, you are not going to be able to get access to the market. And also the mindset. Because in a monopsony market, when you look at procurement process, becomes an extremely important tool for creating opportunity and encouraging private participation. Also in terms of efficiency, here I look at defense through the prism of the 90 PSUs and how many, about 30-odd ordnance factories, probably more. The efficiency of those in terms of the average is much below the average efficiency. When you look at the private sector participation in auto and engineering, I think we're probably there in the right quadrant and all of that, which is the innovation index, export, and productivity. The other issue is about R&D. Both private sector as well as the government is too stingy as far as R&D is concerned. And why are we not investing in R&D? I mean, okay, we should be investing. Some of them are investing. But until unless you don't have orders, you don't have revenues, where are you going to invest in R&D? Or for what should you be investing in R&D for? When you look at the total expenditure on defense R&D, US spends about 11%, China spends about 16 to 18%, India spends 6%, and half of that goes into the administrative cost. When you look at total R&D as a percentage of GDP, we spend about 0.8% of a total 0.8% of the total GDP on R&D. That is extremely less. There's always this issue about capability, or is it capability or is it access to market? I think it is the former. When you look at market opportunity, I think the opportunity is really big, cutting across all the sectors. In terms of technology capability, do we have the brain power? The secretary mentioned there is brain power available. So is R&D a real problem in terms of skill sets? I don't think it is. There are a large number of global MNCs which are operating out of Bangalore and Hyderabad, saving billions in terms of dollars in revenues for their companies. Why can't we do that? There is always this thing about the Indians go and blossom overseas. Why can't they blossom in our own country? One of the examples of that is the a startup which now aspires to send the rover to the moon. And I mean, at the end of the day, it's an Indian startup. If they can aspire, why can't we? So, you know, coming to the manufacturing ecosystem, does it exist in this country? When you look at the competence, we are almost there compared to China. When you look at the Chinese story today, China is in the breakout stage. And probably we have great advantage as compared to China if you look. This is about a year old figure. I'm having a little problem with this. When you look at the capacity, many of the industries today, including some of the small, medium, and small scale enterprises, have invested, have created capacity much ahead of demand. When you look at the capability, we are right there in terms of capability, and if government addresses the issue of utilities, makes it more efficient, we would be the most preferred manufacturing destination, not for frugal manufacturing, but for the right price, high-quality manufacturing destination. Also in terms of vision, whether we're going to get there, I'm not sure. I'm not going to comment on that. But the government has a vision in terms of where the manufacturing should be. It intends to increase manufacturing from 15% of GDP to 25%. And that is a huge task. For that, the manufacturing sector will have to grow at the rate of 15%, probably more, because this was a figure which came out 2 years ago. To understand where we are, it's always good to look at other models. And one of the fashionable things to do in India is to look at the Chinese model, and so I would also do the same. Which does not mean that everything the Chinese did, we should do that. But definitely we could learn from some of the experiences. For example, the Chinese developed hard and soft capabilities after they launched the four modernization in the 80s. There was clear-cut direction from the leadership. They re-engineered the structure sometimes in the 90s. In terms of reforms of research institutes, they spent a large amount towards research, and educational reforms were also carried out. As a result, we have about 3 universities in the top 50 global universities in China. What did we do? We didn't do any. We didn't do any of those. We probably did a few other things, but now we've started doing, some of them, and hence we expect results in a few years. What did the space do? Space did a few, and see where the space was today. Looking at some of the advanced economies, US, Israel, Brazil, France, have private sector presence. UK presence, classic example of a PPP in the defense sector. They kind of hedge risk with the private sector. France, too, kind of supports the PPP model. The export credit agencies, too, play a significant role in many of these advanced defense economies. UK export finance supported the contracts by credit insurance and bonds for the Hawks and Eurofighters to Oman in 2012. As a result, UK's defense exports were almost 50% of the total industrial exports in 2012. Otherwise, it's around 5%. Israel's defense exports about 1/3 of total industrial imports. The 10 largest firms in Israel account for 87% total exports and 82% sales. So when you look at India, I think the game changer here too is going to be the private sector participation. It's because private sector today is well prepared to bring about the changes. They're also moving away from being just raw material suppliers and component manufacturers to developing capabilities in systems integration and producing platforms. In all of this, while government stands to gain because through efficiency, innovation, new commercial techniques, improved quality of services, the private sector gains by access to market, which is extremely important for it to grow. Long-term investments against security of long-term contracts, and participating in this high technology sector will obviously move them up in the value chain. So what's next? I think the trick is that we need to really identify key technologies. Start increasing our spend on R&D. When you identify key technologies, you don't really need to carry out R&D on the entire spectrum of technology. Look at that spectrum which is in the denial and start working on that. We need to leverage from the talent pool. It's an extremely good talent pool that we have. We need to look at least 100 programs under the MAKE category. You have 2 MAKE categories today, one which is government funded and the other which is industry funded. There is huge opportunity in that, which will then give access to markets, not only to large players, but also to medium and small enterprises. Looking at where we are in terms of the stage of the industry, I think there have to be more pragmatic SQRs coming out from the defense headquarters. We need to encourage private sector to compete, cooperate, and also complement the DPSUs. So it's got to be a teamwork that's going to happen. We have to project long-term requirements with multi-year procurement and then have faith in the industry. Exports will have to become a vital strand as we move up into the value chain. So are foreign investments and offsets really going to drive the defense economy? Apparently not. They're just going to be the supercharger in the engine and not the engine itself. What's going to bring about a difference is looking at new models, which is whether it's a systems integrator or PPP model, which are mission-based procurement systems and not process-based, and that's probably what's going to drive. I'm just at the end. Skip that. So at the end, as I conclude, the two things which are going to probably change the entire framework of the defense economy and get that vehicle moving is, one, processes. Until unless we make them less protracted and not retracted, and change the mindset, you're ready to embrace all stakeholders in the defense economy, a partnership which is based on trust, transparency, and openness. This would bring about a paradigm shift in the entire framework. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Vishal. I think, sorry, we had to hurry through, not so much, because I think it's Always the interesting part of the panel discussion is the open Q&A and that open discussion with the rest of the floor. But I think overall, you did sound positive in terms of where our technological capabilities are and in terms of the overall policy framework. I seem to be somewhat more of a skeptic, but I think you have reasons, and I'm sure there are going to be a lot of questions on that particular regard in terms of why we are not able to move that car in a sense and where are the still hiccups that we still have in place. Now, let me open the floor for discussion, and we have about 25 minutes, almost an hour for discussion. So if you can identify yourself and the organization that you represent, and questions, comments can be brief, I think that will give us a lot more time for Q&A. First user.
Hello. Also former Indian Ambassador Surendra Kumar, my question is to Mr. Stephen. Sir, you mentioned that the UK is now the second largest defense exporter. My question is very simple. In your defense export deals with India, you insert a clause, no middleman has been used or will be used. We have in the past very bad experience in this regard. No middleman has been used. Is this clause inserted in your defense deals with India? Thank you.
It is a complicated issue. I think the answer is I don't know. I don't think it's actually a specific clause. I think we have a framework of procurement regulations around how we do procurement in the UK, and companies are expected to comply with that. Whether it's specifically in there about middlemen in our procurement contracts, I don't know the answer to. And of course, what we do is work with our companies to make sure they comply with regulations when they're selling abroad with the regulations of that country, and also the ones that we have in the UK around using agents and those sorts of requirements. And I know India's been through quite a bit of change around this, but it's a good question. I think it's to do with the generic legal framework rather than specific clauses in the UK.
Somebody can pass on a mic at the back there, please. To the table there.
Hi, this is Manu Pabi from the Economic Times. The question is related to the first one, not the same though. You know, as India and the UK get together and the private sector is the way forward, transparency and, you know, accountability and, you know, upholding integrity will be a very important part of it. And as we've seen in the past, there have been some incidents of, you know, people working on the edge of law. What I want to know is that what can the Indian and the UK industry do together to get over this, you know, this distrust factor? Is there something beyond just the regulations and the governance clauses that are there that exist between the two? Is there something that can be done together, you know, to ensure that this past is actually behind us and we can move forward on something better, more transparent?
Let me answer some of that question for you. I mean, if you look at the issue of around bribery and corruption legislation, for example, the UK's got the highest standard in the world. We have the highest bar. And as a consequence of that, our companies strive to have the highest level of ethics and the way to do business going forwards. And if you look at, you know, some of the more recent examples of some of the problems there have been, they are in the past. Very much now our companies are operating in a very different world and a different way. And the trust that we certainly have between the government and our main contractors in that regard, in their compliance procedures, is at an all-time high, I would say, in the UK. And when we go and talk to other countries, other countries' governments about their procurement processes, we obviously reflect that fact with them in our discussions, that our expectation is that our industry operates with the highest amounts of trust and transparency. We have a whole load of processes in the UK that help us confirm that that's the case, that working environment's the case, and we want to have other countries participate with us in making sure that that is the way of doing business going forward. So you're right, it's a long, slow process, but we believe we've got very, very high bars for this in our country, and it's something we want to share with other countries around the world.
I'm Commodore Ajay Singh, formerly from the Indian Navy and a former Defence and Naval Advisor to the Indian High Commission in London. At a time when UKTI, we dissociated from the MOD to the UKTI, sir. I think Nigam and General Narasimhan have clearly brought out the ills that plague our whole defence procurement system. We all know what needs to be done, everybody. But obviously it's not getting done. Now why it's not getting done is a million-dollar question. The UK, on the other hand, has gone perhaps very fast into the transformation process. When I was there, there were a couple of people who advised me that follow our transformation process, but don't do it so fast because we made mistakes. It's very difficult to come back from now. From the armed forces point of view, the minister mentioned about things like carrier strike and Nimrod capability. I think the British armed forces really lamented loss of that capability and getting it back now, where he made an allusion to that Indian aircraft carrier experience may be used by the Brits to get back their aircraft carrier experience, which is surprising. Nevertheless, the point I'm trying to make is, and this is General Narasimhan and Nigam, that what will get that level of trust to be developed between private industry and the political leadership and the bureaucracy to be able to allow private industry to be an equal stakeholder, as it is in the UK, where I'll give you a very small example. I'm a submariner. The British Submarine Rescue Service is run by one commander and one petty officer. That's all. It's company owned, company operated. And they have committed to deliver wherever delivery is required, whenever, and for that number of days a year. That same equipment is now coming to India. It's a contract which India and UK have signed. But we are going for a proper government owned, government operated model with a huge infrastructure which we're going to create around it. So why can we not trust our private industry enough to offload these kind of services to the private industry where they would be expected to deliver?
Basically, what is actually holding us back are two things. One is the mindset, which has come in over a period of time. But you see this in the process that the defense procurement procedure has taken place. Starting from 2005, when this procedure every time got revised, it became tighter. Now is an effort that is being made to make it more open, more participatory. So it's a matter of time probably that we will look into that trust business with the private industry. That is one. The second thing is the organizational structures that we needed, they need to be undergoing a little modification, which at the moment is being looked into. I think the mindset and the organizational procedures and the structure, if these are changed, I think the desired result will be there.
Yes. So, yeah, sir, like you said, I don't know what's going to change to, you know, make them trust us more than what they've done in the past, but we haven't really done anything why they should not be trusting us. So I guess time would be the best healer in terms of as far as trust is concerned. But now on a serious note, I think it's a function of mindset, which takes probably generations for a mindset to change. So it's going to happen. The other thing we need to do is we need to look at the structures, re-engineering structures. And once that is done, the government will probably realize that it's a good idea to trust the industry more than it's done in the past. Also, just to give you an example, when you look at the 90s, that's the time when the Indian economy opened up. It was the private sector which actually drove the economy. And maybe we're going to learn lessons from the past and start trusting the industry more.
maybe one thing from the UK experience, and as you rightly said, there's been positive things and some learning from that, is that the one thing that strikes you about the UK government, the Ministry of Defence and other ministries that deal with the defence industry in the UK, is the closeness of the relationship. It is a daily dialogue. I see the chief execs of our top companies once every month. Most officials in government have a relationship at all levels of those major defence companies in the UK. We have formal forums where we can discuss matters around terms and conditions and around other conditions set in terms of defence contracting. We have joint innovation initiatives working between joint R&D, between the MOD and between industry, and we have lots of different funded activities that do that, including one recently which the Secretary of State announced for £800 million of funding for new innovation with the defence industry to support them in their innovation thinking going forwards to find new capabilities. So there's a very, very, very close dialogue. And even though we've made mistakes, it feels like a very close community. So that trust is built up over many years by joint working together is one of the ways that certainly that's happened in the UK.
Thank you. Dinakar at the back. Somebody a mic near the bar.
Yes. At the mic. My name is Major Chakravarti.
Sir, can you just, I'll just come back to you, sir.
Okay. Who wants to?
Dinakar, can you pick up the pint, please? Sorry.
Which one?
Dinakar at the back.
This is regarding the issue of transparency to the first speaker, and a follow-up question to Manu, what he asked. In fact, there are a couple of individuals being investigated regarding practices in the defense deals, particularly, and who happen to be in London right now. So is there some discussion between the two governments to sort the issue and, you know, facilitate their exchange or to bring a closure to the issue, essentially, both the company and the individuals? Is something of that sort going on?
Obviously, we can't comment on specific cases. I mean, we can't possibly do that. Other than to repeat what I said before, is that we have the highest levels of transparency and compliance in terms of what we're trying to do here. That's shared with other countries. And, you know, we absolutely work very closely with the companies to make sure that they do work with us in terms of adhering to the law. We can't comment on any individual cases that are going on there.
Okay. Thank you for that. Just to clarify saying, Not getting into specific cases, but is there any formal mechanism between the two governments or two defense ministries in the works, something to sort out things in future? Because what you're looking at is much more deeper partnership. So these things might arise in future. So is some kind of understanding, discussion, some arrangement?
There is on generally setting the right conditions. I mean, these sorts of investigations, though, are not down to the Ministry of Defense. They're down to our police authorities that do this. So, but in terms of defence discussion, in terms of joint contracting and things of this nature, there is a dialogue that goes on. We talked about capability dialogues around how we might share experiences between the two agencies.
Okay. Two questions, one to our friend from the UK and then to General Narasimhan. Sir, the Defence Secretary was talking about how you got rid of your Nimrod capability. That's fine for you because you're a NATO ally and your NATO allies will fill that capability. I was wondering how that example would actually apply to India. And the second part, sir, for you, General Narasimhan, is regarding bloat. The Army, for example, has over 100 golf courses, suitably renamed recreational facilities and things. When are we actually looking at getting rid of all that excess bloat, the real bloat, to make the Army more effective?
So I think the question was around the Nimrod capability. Yeah? So the maritime patrol aircraft. So we have now got an arrangement with on the P-8 MPA. So with the U.S. government to take on board the P-8 as our MPA to replace what we did have originally with the Nimrod capability. And I'm pleased to say, as part of that, of course, Boeing's the main contractor. Boeing is making large investments into the UK in terms of what they're providing to us, in terms of investing capability, joint investing with our industry to be able to grow their presence in the UK as a result of that. So we've had the benefit of, as you say, working with a joint NATO ally on that type of capability with the P8. And we've also had the benefit of the contractor then coming to the UK and working with our defence industry to do co-investment as a result of it. So we think of that as a win-win situation.
This is regarding the question of rationalization and to make things more economical and useful. There was a study we just carried out some time back called the Transformation Study, which included all this. Somewhere down the line, the implementation is still in the process and it is going on. It will take some time, I presume, but I think that is being looked into.
To the second table on the right, please, can I get the mic?
Oh, thank you, Chair. I'm Major Chakravarti. My first question is to the British representative. You have never given us any niche technology. All you have given us is a screwdriver and a hammer, you know, to be used, and you are manufacturing Hawk, and probably the lowest end technologies. And you've been promising in all these lovely air conditioned rooms you'll do it. I've been actually involved. I'm sorry to say that Britain has never come forward. The only country that's really come forward is Russia. And are you really going to now get this talk moved to walk? When are you going to do it? Next is to Vishal Nigam. Since I've worked so closely with Bharat Forge, a few corrections. I've made 19 SQRs myself. About 4 make projects have been made. I don't want to name them. I think the industry needs to firstly understand the SQR. The second thing, what really is, do you feel that the private sector will come in straight away? Or what is best being done is joint ventures where you have a lot of private-public cooperation. I totally agree with General Nambiar. You can't have a thing come overnight. Where do you have send all these 39 ordnance factories? You have one in Nalanda, which even doesn't manufacture. Can Bharat Forge, again, has Bharat Forge delivered anything till today? I've been involved with your trials and equipment. Has Tata's delivered anything to the artillery today? Yes, Tata L&T have delivered Pinaka. So, if you feel, and they have delivered it because they cooperated with DRDO. I don't see a clean run private sector anywhere, at least for the, you know, army or the navy. It has to be a PPP to start with, and then next, unless you feel that all your points. And last, which I want to point out, processes, I think, have been made very open. Tata's came into my office without appointment, said 5 minutes and took 5 hours. What better cooperation can you have? Unless these slides are looking. I think we have made Bharat Forge, I have given about 100 appointments. Without appointment, they have walked in. Mr. Lay, I leave it to you what you want to answer.
Right, so anyway, great. Thank you for that question. That's a really good challenge to us. Of course, you know, from our perspective, it's not just screwdrivers. We have transferred a lot of technology. I would point you towards the relationship going back to the 70s on the Jaguar fast jet program through to the Hawk now, which is produced by HAL. All of the indigenous transfer of technology has resulted in upgrades coming through from local Indian creation as a result of that, which is a lot more. I mean, if HAL were here, I think they'd agree it's a lot more than just screwdrivers. So I think there's a lot of specific technology that's been transferred there. And of course, not to even mention the advances, as Secretary of State talked about, in terms of jet engine technology and what's been happening there with some of our major working together with companies like Rolls-Royce, working with DRDO. So there's been a lot of transfer of technology there. But I would make one comment. One thing in terms of when I talk to our contractors about the ability to transfer much more technology, part of it is around the stability in the IP legal framework in India, making sure that there is a way of protecting intellectual property is always at the top of their minds, and making sure that the ability is there, that they feel confident that they can transfer technology and that can be held in safe hands when it gets to India. So there is a bit of that. Although we have proven for years, right back to the 70s, that we've been able to transfer very high technology to the country, I think.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Jen Chakravarti. Anyway, sir, today the discussion wasn't about what Bharat Forge has done or is going to do. The discussion was more in terms of the defense economy. I'm a little more optimistic in terms of my understanding of the defense economy and the future which lies for the private sector. In terms of processes, I think, I mean, it's just about perception. You probably perceive that the processes are fine. I perceive the processes are changing, but they need to be less protracted. I think many of us sitting here in the room would also mention the same, that the processes need to be less protracted. On a serious note, when you have long protracted cycles, what it does actually to the country in terms of building capability is that you end up getting a minus one generation platform and or a system rather than getting a plus one generation platform and system. All that I was trying to allude to was that can we have a more efficient process which can be completed at least within the timelines mentioned in the DPPs.
Thank you. Next to the second table on the right, on the left.
Okay. Me?
Okay, can you just pass it on to him first? I'll just come back to you on the second table.
thank you very much for these interesting presentations. My name is Sujit Samadar. My question is on two parts. First, in the last year of DAC decisions, that's the Defense Acquisition Council decisions, almost 50% of those decisions have been through the foreign military sales routes. Now, I want to understand how does the UK work the game? You've spoken about how the government of UK is promoting defense exports. Are you going to put together an equivalent of a foreign military sales program in your own country for easier cooperation between India and UK? That's first. The second is, when you're looking at technology cooperation, India has already joined the MTCR and soon will be following up with the Wassenaar arrangement and will be in the entire gamut of strategic trade controls. Now, technology and the munitions list are going to be very serious matters when we discuss third country exports, particularly domestic manufacturing in our own country. So I want to understand from you, and particularly from the UK's experience, as you showed, you all do £8 billion of exports here, and much of them would be probably under strategic trade controls. Would you be able to share those best practices so that the government of India can put together structures that would align itself with the strategic trade controls, and how can we cooperate together in firming up these issues? I'm presently with NITI Aayog as a senior consultant.
So let me do the export third-party controls. You're right. In terms of what I described as a new trend, a lot of our work is now about transferring technologies and co-creating together new designs. When we do that, of course, we control a lot of those technologies. Not all of them, but some of them are very sensitive technologies because they give us military advantage and they're classified technologies. So when we do that, as well as having the industrial relationship, we have to have what we call a government-to-government relationship. And in that government-to-government relationship, we will agree together with that government. And we've done it a few times now, so we're starting to get experience about this, about how we will discuss any potential third-party exports together, because they have to meet the test and the criteria of our export controls and the country's export controls. Some of them, it's been a very interesting experience, because some countries have not thought about the consequences of third-party exports and are just starting to do it. And we're having some very interesting dialogues with some countries about how to set up joint units together to be able to accommodate that. So it's something we absolutely want to work with India with and use that experience and be able to co-create those agencies that can control those exports in a timely way. The first question was about the American foreign military sales system. I can tell you the UK has no intention of setting up an FMS process. What we have worked out is that the FMS process is very strong. So if you look at the last 40 years of defense contracting around the world, and you think of it as about an $80 billion market, the Americans have got about $50 billion of that. And that's working using FMS. And that's really a legal process in the United States, which enables them to transfer military technology to their allies. And rather than selling a fast jet, they'll tend to sell an Air Force. So the complete package of all the support that goes with that. That locks you into the American system. So many countries around the world have got FMS capability. A lot of very close countries to us have got FMS Air Forces, for example. But as well as continuing down that route, they're looking at how they can develop their own indigenous capability whilst maintaining an FMS route with the United States. And that's where we get countries like Korea, Turkey, Korea with the KFX program, Turkey with the TFX program, the Japanese with their future fighter program, thinking in their Air Force context of continuing on with FMS, but also developing indigenous activity. And it's that indigenous creation that gives us the opportunity to work closely with those governments. We're never going to compete with FMS. That's a very different sort of process. But in terms of commercial sales, we have a lot more UK government equities that we can put in there to support our industry to form a partnership on those new indigenous programs. And that's the focus that we've got in terms of working alongside the FMS program from the US.
Thank you. There's going to be, I think we are because we started a few minutes early and we haven't had General Poffley joining us, and he's going to do his remarks before we start the next panel. So I want to quickly break off for lunch so that, what I'm going to do is now two or three questions in one go, and we can combine and ask the panelists to answer in a joint manner. Over to you.
Okay, thank you. My question is to Vishal and Stephen. Have you identified the areas where you would like to have alliances and technologies with Indian companies? Also that Secretary Defense mentioned that the gas turbine technology is in Hawks. Now that's not a niche technology, it's an existing technology. So I don't know what is going to be the advantage of gas turbine technology. One more question is that how do you compare cost of defense equipment manufacturing in India with new technologies with other countries? You do have a manufacturing base in 35 countries for the defense equipments. Thank you for both of you.
To the front, the first right now.
Thank you, Chair. Ekajan, I think Vishal gave a very brilliant presentation, and very systematically and convincingly he advocated the case of privatization and PPP in defense sector. He also gave the example of the comparison between China and India. But one point which I want to understand is how much China has gone for privatization and PPP in defense sector. And related with this is the another question. You said that about the DPSUs are running at about 1/3 of their efficiency. Is it a case for divestment of these PSUs in India?
Can we get to the mic to the second table on the right? And I think that's going to be the last question, unless there is...
Thank you, sir. I have a question for Mr. Nigam. I am Major General Rajiv Narayanan, Distinguished Fellow with the USI. I thought what I could gather from you, you are still looking at a monopsony market, because you mentioned that during the course of your discussion. But I don't think that is what the PM looks at as Make in India. And related to that comes to the SQRs. If you're going to degrade your SQRs, you're not going to get markets abroad. So your SQRs, what you're looking at, technology has to be sellable to the world outside, even if it's a third world country. And that leads to how much of risk-taking ability do you have? The government can only extend its hands that much. Please don't expect the government to take all the risks. That was one of the things which you could hear from the speaker from England say, that the government shed some of its responsibility so that the private sector has the capability to take the risk. But that risk-taking issue never came out in your presentation. How much risk are you going to take? Second issue is on R&D, which you had flagged. I'm sorry, sir. The MNCs which have the R&D lab here do not have their niche technology with them. All the systems that are being made around the world, whether it is R&D or whether it's a completed system, there is a lead integrator. No single entity can make everything by itself. There is a lead integrator. Similarly with the technology is broken down into high technology, higher technology, and the niche technology that is needed. All labs of foreign countries who are running in India make only the high and higher end technology. the niche technology lab is still in their country where everything else is integrated. Whether you take Intel or any other country, nobody is going to give you that. We have to reach out to our institutions. Are we reaching out? Is the private sector reaching out in the defense industry to our IITs and other technological institutions, giving them funding for these technology developments that they need? I don't think so. I think we need to look towards that. Your comments, please.
Thank you, and I think we'll come back to the panelists for making any closing remarks as well. But my own one question in that sense was, do we have an efficient, sound ecosystem where there is an integration between the R&Ds and institutions, higher education bodies, in that sense, to create that system where you bring in the talent from the education institutions, universities, and other labs to industries for a seamless integration? Does that happen? That's one point. Second to our Stephen is the whole point about, you know, at any point, I think this is always going to be a challenge, creating that right interface between the government, private sector, and the armed forces, and how easy that has been in the case of the UK in the last few years that you have been in this experiment. And I think between Vishal and Narasimhan, I think that's my point I wanted to cover in a sense. Thank you, and we will go in the reverse order. Start with you, Vishal.
So I'll probably start with the last question from the general, which was a pretty loaded question. So it's not that the Indian private sector is looking for monopsony. I mean, monopsony exists. We operate in that. When you're looking for export markets, in the defense economy, first you have to sell the equipment and platform in your own country. And that's how you can then go to another country and say that this is a platform that we have. We, our country utilizes that platform, and hence now we are there to sell it in the other country. The third part of your question was about the R&D. Whether enough is being done, I said enough is not being done there. And that was your question as well, Raji. We need to do more. When you look at the numbers itself, the private sector is not investing enough, so is the government not investing enough. Do we need to increase investment in R&D? We surely need to increase our investments in R&D. In terms of synergy and setting up incubators, I think that's work in progress. It has started. It's going to take some more time. We need to be patient, and things will happen. Coming to the question from you, sir, about China's privatization, I have no data on what is the privatization or how much privatization is taken. I only know one thing, that sometimes in the mid-2000s, Chinese opened up its market to Airbus to set up their base in Tianjin. They rolled out an Airbus in 2009. After that, they started, or during that period of time, simultaneously, they started also working on the C919 and ARJ21. And so it is not only spin-offs, but also spin-ins. And we need to look at it from that perspective. In terms of case for divestment, I'll leave it to the government to think about it.
Okay, thank you. In terms of the integration and the way that works across the UK, infrastructure. There's a few comments to make there. First of all, we have at the beginning of each parliament what we call an SDSR, Security and Defence. Strategic Defence and Security Review. That's it, right? The right way around. And in there, we set out what we're going to do for the parliament in terms of defence for the next 4 years. And part of it this time round was the support from MOD to exports, was our Ministry of Defence, our frontline commands, everyone involved in our Ministry of Defence, being part of our prosperity push to be able to go out and advocate for technologies, to be able to push those into and share those with other countries. And that's been a really positive thing in joining up what we do across government. So I'd say there's a policy angle here to government wanting to do exports and support industry to do it. If I can, just a couple of other comments that came up. There was a comment on India cost, which I thought was quite interesting. India cost is very good. So when we compare British platforms that have been made in the UK and where we've made transfers to India, the economics are very good, definitely. India is much better, many, after some experience at producing some of those things at more economic cost. But cost is only one part of this. The defense exporting market is cost sensitive, but cost is just one element. It accounts for less than 20% of the decision by the government overseas. More importantly, is it in service? What's the doctrine around it? What's the training package around it? What's the service and reliability of that platform? There's a lot of other parameters that make the decision right. So cost is just one element. So if we're thinking it's just about cost, it's not. There's a lot more to it than cost, I think, which is important.
I have only two, 3 points to sum up with. One is, I think we need to look at jointness a lot more, not only between the armed forces, but even between the private sector amongst themselves, and also between the private sector and the DPSUs, etc. The second thing is on the joint R&D. Again, R&D in this country has been, particularly in the defense sector, has been the domain of the DRDO. And this is the time we need to actually branch out and look at how private sector and DRDO can join hands together and take this process forward. And also joint production. BrahMos is one of the success stories that we have had in this country. Probably we need to look at a joint production mechanism which will take this thing forward. And lastly, the mindset which I mentioned to you earlier, all there needs to be a change. And something is happening on that front. A little faster would help us a lot. Thank you.
General, would you just have one line about the whole accountability process? Because like you talked about the R&D and how the DRDO has been the single agency that has been doing most of it. And there are obviously the story of DRDO, the success and the failures, we all know about it. So would you suggest, would you see some mechanism of something of that kind coming about, in a sense, to bring about greater accountability?
This has been in the mind of the government and other agencies for some time now. The basic thing has been that for a long time, accountability has been given a little second row seat. That is something we need to look into. And a good model probably would be something like what DARPA has in US. It's purely accountably oriented. A specific time is given, a specific project is given, a specific money is given. You don't do it, you get out, and another guy comes in. And the number of people who are working on the project are fairly very, very less compared to what we have in DRDO and other laboratories here. We need to look at different models to do this, and accountability is definitely a thing that one needs to look into.
Thank you, and we missed General Pawfley in the last this panel, but he's going to be doing his remarks right after the lunch. But at this stage, let me thank the panelists, and I think we have had a fascinating discussion. A hand of applause to all the panelists out here, and thank you all for contributing to this debate.